Welcome to the Ministry of Living on the Edge with Chip Ingram. We trust that the upcoming message will inspire, encourage, and motivate you to apply what you learn as you live out your faith in Christ at home and at work each day. At the end of the message, you'll find information on how to contact Living on the Edge or obtain additional resources. Now, here's Chip.
What I want to do is I want to give you a picture of something that was commonplace. A Levite was a man between the ages of 20 and 50. He had to be out of the line of Aaron, the priesthood, and that was the section of the Levites that did the important ministry or priestly work. And one of the jobs of some of the Levites was to transcribe the text of the Torah. And I want you to picture, as you can imagine, a man somewhere between 20 and 50, at 50 automatic retirement, and his job was to take the written text of the Torah and rewrite on another scroll exactly what was on the scroll that was given him. And the accuracy had to be this level of integrity, is once he was done with his day's work, an older Levite would come with a pen and count over so many letters, maybe 25 letters, count down 17 letters, and he would put his pen on a letter. And if the letter in this scroll did not match the letter of that scroll, they would tear it up and start over. The integrity and the margin for error was zero tolerance. But something else also happened. As a Levite would be, and if you can imagine in your mind's eye the meticulous copying of the text, you know, Genesis, Exodus, Deuteronomy, Numbers, and then he would get to, let's pretend he's actually doing Exodus chapter 20. And when he got to the word Yahweh, in fact, he would never pronounce it. It was too holy to pronounce. The vowels were not written in, just those four letters, Y, W, H, W, and R. And when he got to that, he would stop. And he would go into another room, and he would remove his outer garment. He would ceremonially wash. He would put on a clean outer garment. He would come back in, and then he would very carefully write those four letters, Y, W, H, W in Hebrew. And then he would take the utensil that he wrote the holy name, which is too holy to pronounce, and he would destroy it. He would go into another room, take the robe off, the outer robe, when he wrote that name, set it aside, ceremonially cleanse himself again, put on a new robe, and then come back and begin to rewrite the text again. And you know what he did the next time he came to the word Yahweh or Jehovah? Exactly the same thing. The name of God was holy. And what I want to talk about is how different that is, their mindset and the reasoning then versus today. Now, by contrast, let's just imagine that you walked into a business office, an insurance agency, someone doing a few sales calls, just any normal business office, and it's a Tuesday and things are kind of busy, and it's one of those open-ended places where there's a lot of desks and a lot of people on the phone, and it's easy to overhear, and there's a real dynamic, and a guy in the corner has made a call, and he's having a real problem because the production people aren't getting things out, and he says something like, "What do you mean there's a problem? They ordered that last week. For Jesus Christ's sake, get it out. What's the problem here? My God, can't anybody do anything right there?" Would that be pretty common in our day? Yeah, I think so. Or let's take it from there, and there's four guys on a couch, and they're not doing a commercial, and they're not necessarily even drinking Bud Light, but they're watching a big ball game, and it's the final four. And it's in the final four, and it's in the last game, and a guy breaks away, and the score is tied. He goes up. He can leap out of this world. There's a little tiny guard, and I actually saw this happen. The guy spreads his legs, jumps over him, and slams it down. And every guy on the couch goes, "Oh, my God, what a dunk, what a slam. Can you believe that? For Jesus' sake, the guy can fly." Isn't that normal? See, the way the ancient Hebrews viewed the name of God and how it was used, and the way the average American, the way the average person on this earth, and in fact, the way the average even born-again believer views God's name and what it means, is night and day. And this third command is a bit radical. The two scenes I've painted are a study in contrast. The one is extreme reverence, going well beyond anything God commanded. There's no commands about never ever speaking his name and that I have in Scripture. And the other extreme irreverence, demonstrating total disregard for the name of God. And the questions I want to ask and answer as we look at those two extremes is, why are we to treat God's name with such holiness? What does it mean to take the Lord's name in vain? What's behind this command? I mean, I didn't grow up in the church. I mean, when I first read this and did the research, part of me said, you know, what's the big deal? I mean, is it real? I mean, does it really, you call him this or say that word or that word? I mean, is there really that much behind it? What difference does it really make? And candidly, why is God so adamant about this? As we study this, you're going to find that this isn't one of those non-negotiables, there's a little fudge, you know, God, there's no, this is black and white. I mean, we're on the Ten Commandments, and this is in the top three. The command is, you shall not misuse, or the word for misuse is literally take up in vain the name of the Lord your God. That word misuse literally means to carry or to bear or to lift up. It's used elsewhere in Scripture. Someone would lift up a song or lift up a poem. It means to verbalize one's allegiance. It's the taking of a name, the verbalizing of a name. It's lifting or carrying something on your lips. And then the word here for vain means with no purpose, void, empty, or with evil intent. So understanding the what is really not very difficult. Don't bring to your lips, take upon your lips the name of God in such a way where it has no purpose, no intent. Never do it with any evil intent, but it always has to have meaning. You have to be thinking about who that you're talking about, and we'll learn why in just a minute. That's the command. The consequences are, for the Lord will not leave him unpunished or hold him guiltless who misuses or takes his name in vain. And as we look at this then, let's dig in a little bit and see if we can't figure out what's in a name. I mean, why is this command so heavy? Name is synonymous with one's character, reputation, and authority. We don't tend to think of it that way, but in scriptural times, ancient times, names were very, very important. Abram, when God did a great work, changed his name to what? Abraham. Sarai, you know, God was doing something in her life, her name changed to Sarah. We had Saul, who was the murderer, and his name was changed to Paul. You have multiple times in Scripture when God was going to talk about what was going to occur in a person's life, and Peter, right, used to be Simon, and upon this rock. Names are very, very important because names are synonymous with one's character, reputation, and authority. Names are synonymous with a person's character, a person's reputation, and authority. In essence, God's name reveals his essence, who he really is. When the name Yahweh, in fact, often what they would do instead of using Yahweh, they would take another name for God, Adonai, so they wouldn't have to give his covenant name. But when the word Yahweh came to the lips, there's content, his character, it's his covenant name. When Jehovah, or the word Yahweh, this is a God who always keeps his promises. When he's making a promise to his people, it's always, I, the Lord. In your Bibles, capital L-O-R-D, say this. And so it's very important. He's not only a covenant-keeping promise keeper, but it's his redemptive name. When he says, the Lord delivered you out of Egypt, the Lord delivered you from the Philistines, the Lord delivered you, the content of his name, Yahweh, has to do with not only his covenant name, but his redemptive name. He's the lover of his people. He's their Savior. And the third, it's his personal name. When he met, remember Moses, burning bush? I am that I am. It's his personal name. It's just not an idea about what he's done, but it is personal identity. I am the ever-existing eternal one. And so when the name Yahweh or Jehovah, or in our day, Lord or God, is used, God's character, reputation, and authority, the very essence of who he is. And so to evoke the name of God is to call upon to your remembrance his personhood, his deeds, his promises, and his very presence. So how important is his name? When Jesus was asked by his disciples, you know, we notice that John, you know, he prays with his disciples, and the Pharisees, boy, they, you know, they've got a pretty rigorous way that they pray. And we notice you are very habitual about getting up early in the morning and getting away. And there's an intimacy that you have with God that we've never seen before. Will you teach us to pray? And Jesus in Matthew 6 taught him to pray. And the first thing he said, what? There's a different kind of relationship. When he taught them our Father who is in heaven, the concept of Father was radical. The Hebrews of the day had a very strong sense of God's transcendence, in other words, his awesomeness, but not the idea that he could be eminent, that he could be close. And he used the word Abba. It was the word that small toddler children call upon their mom or dad to climb up into their lap. But then notice right after he said, our Father who art in heaven, what's the very first thing he taught him? Hallowed be thy name. Holy is your name. And so he's saying here that his covenant name, in essence, is we're to take God, right in the word, seriously. We're to take God very, very seriously. And that applies not only to God, but to Jesus. Jesus' identity and his name was discussed, remember? What shall he be called? His name will be called Emmanuel. God is with us. The word Jesus means what? Savior or salvation. Jesus made it clear. Remember in John chapter 8, before Abraham was, remember, I am. And he made clear, he's the ego a me. He said, I want you to know that your view of the eternal God, the I am that I am, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Remember in the garden when they came and they had swords and clubs and torches and they said, who are you looking for? And he uses that same phrase. And when he says that phrase, do you remember what happened? The power of the name, the people fell down to the floor. I am he. I am the I am. And so there's real power in the name of God, and it's to be taken very seriously. And here's the axiom. Our use of God's name in word, in thought, or deed will reflect our view of God and our relationship to him. How you think about God's name, how you use God's name, in word or thought or deed will reflect the view and the relationship you have with him. And what happens is when we don't have a high view of God, it becomes visible and apparent in how we talk. I have had this experience multiple times with my kids, and then I kind of quit because it just got too painful. But I remember one apparent time where you know, I was real tired and came through a big time, and so I really wanted to treat our family. So I heard from all my friends, or at least from a number of people, that this was a good movie, okay? We're going to go see this good movie. And so, you know, it was the days where we couldn't, you know, put two quarters against each other, so to buy movie tickets and popcorn and the whole deal, and we all lined up and sat down. And it started out, was kind of a family-friendly movie and seemed to have a good plot and seemed like kind of a nice time. But I don't know what it was, but early on in this movie, someone started with the GD expression. GD this, GD that, GD this, GD that. And you know, it was kids and family oriented. It was like, this feels like a family movie. The music is like a family movie. It has kind of the Disney feel. But boy, early on there's this blank, blank, this, blank, blank, this. And I sat there. And I thought, well, am I going to weather through this, and how much of this am I going to take? And I just had this thought come to me. And I thought, who's the most precious person in my life? I mean, who's the person whose respect that I would guard, whose reputation I would guard? And I thought, you know, it's my wife or one of my kids. And I thought, would I sit in this movie theater if they were saying, Teresa, damn this, Teresa, damn this, Teresa, I call on Teresa to damn and send people to hell, and just, and then using her word, not even just like a slur or a fill-in, man, I would get up in front of that theater and say, hey, I'll tell you what, the next guy who says my wife's name like that, you know, I may lose this battle, but I'm going to try and take you out. I mean, wouldn't you, men? If someone said that about one of your kids or about your mom, and I thought to myself, I'm not doing this. And so my kids, this had happened before, and I gave them the, okay, we all filed out. Burned about $7 a person, and I'm going, And of course, it was a teachable moment. And you know what it helped me see? It helped me see that our view of God's name and our sense of what it means and how important it is says a lot about where we're at with Him. And I think what's happened in our culture, candidly, is we've gotten very casual. And the name of God doesn't mean much to the world. And unfortunately, the name of God in many ways doesn't mean too much to the church. And I think we're not going, you know, words matter. Words really matter. There's no way ideas are expressed through words. So words have content. And when the content of a word is devalued and over time gets degraded so that it doesn't mean anything, then the concept in your mind and the idea in your mind is you will have a low view of God if we get to the point where we talk about Him tritely and casually, or are you ready? If you use His name in vain. And so what I want to talk about is, in what ways do we use God's name in vain? And by the way, you're going to learn that profanity, of course, is one, but probably the most serious in the cultural context, this third command was not given primarily with regard to profanity, although it's definitely included. The primary application of this is in the taking of oaths. And you'll notice in your notes, it says, in the taking of oaths that we do not keep, write the word perjury. It's a legal term, perjury. And the historical context, you can jot down under that Deuteronomy 6:13 and Deuteronomy 10:20. And both those say, fear the Lord your God and take an oath in my name. Again, you got to remember, they've come out of this pagan culture. No one told the truth. There was no sense of right, wrong. This is good. This is bad. And so, you know, as God is teaching these people how to live before Him, one of the things He wants them to learn is to tell the truth. And so if you're in a business deal and you say you're going to do that and He's going to do that, well, then what you say in the name of the Lord, because, I mean, it is so holy, you would never break your vow. And by the time centuries roll on, by the time years and years would happen, people would then not use the name of the Lord in an oath. They would say, I swear by Jerusalem, or I swear by this, or I swear by that. They were looking for legal loopholes. They took the very command of God and tried to use it as a way so that when they didn't tell the truth, they say, well, you know, I didn't swear by the name of the Lord. So much so that by Matthew chapter 5, about verse 46, remember when Jesus was talking about, you have heard it said, you know, swear by heaven or swear by earth, but I say to you, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Basically, Jesus said, let's forget all this oath stuff. The whole point of taking an oath in the name of God was to bring about integrity, and you've actually taken the command to build integrity into the life of Israel and used it for a legal loophole so you don't tell the truth. So He said, you know what I want you to do? Just tell the truth all the time. Forget oaths. But when you would say to a person, I, in the name of God, commit to marry that woman or that man. I, in the name of God, will pay so much for that field. I, in the name of God, have a treaty with this group of people that we're at war with. It is unbreakable. On the basis of the name and the integrity of the Creator and the Deliverer and the Redeemer of all the people of Israel, I will never break this oath. So the issue was being a person of your word. And when you would take the name of the Lord and then not keep your promise, you were misusing or taking the name of God in vain. Notice Leviticus 19:12. Do not make a promise in my name if you do not intend to keep it. That brings disgrace on my name. I am, and then here's His name, the Lord or Yahweh, your God. This one, how many times have you been to a wedding? I've done a lot of them as a pastor, 20 plus years. And isn't there a place in the wedding where we say to this couple, before God and these witnesses, do you take this man to be your lawful wedded wife? I do, I do. Do you take this woman to be your lawful wedded wife? I do, I do. In sickness and in health and sorrow and, right? As long as you both shall live. Before God, oath, and these witnesses. You understand when a couple, now do I understand there are biblical grounds for divorce and there's infidelity and people run off? Yes. Do I understand that some people are married to unbelievers? And 1 Corinthians 7, an unbeliever can abandon a believer and people may find themselves divorced. Well, now that we have 10% of all the divorces in the evangelical community covered, what about the other 90%? I'm not fulfilled. This is really hard. I'm not very happy right now. When we as Christians break our vow or our oaths to God, we are taking the name of the Lord in vain. And would you mind going back, if you don't have it open, and look at the very first page where it says we're not to take the name of the Lord in vain? And did you notice the consequences there? For the Lord will not leave him unpunished or hold him guiltless who misuses or takes his name in vain. Any of you businessmen, businesswomen here, ever had a business deal with another Christian? You know, they had a little fish on their card, or when you got the card, there's a little fish on the back of the card. And have you had the first round of things where they're a Christian and you're a Christian, and since you're both Christians, and we probably don't even need to sign anything because your word is gold, you both love God, you're people of integrity. I would just be interested. How many people have had one of those experiences with one of those so-called Christians? Maybe they were, maybe they weren't, and you got ripped off. I did. You know what they did? They took the name of the Lord in vain. They broke their promise. It was on the basis of your relationship that, in my case, I've had times where I didn't sign a contract, my lands. This guy loves God, I love God. If I can't trust his word, what can I trust? And what I learned is I couldn't trust his word. You break an oath. You might jot down Psalm 15:4. Psalm 15:4 is talking about the kind of man, the kind of woman that God promises to bless. And Psalm 15 opens with a question and it ends with a promise. And it opens with a question and says, "Oh God, oh Lord, who may abide in thy holy tent? Who may dwell with you?" In other words, who can have intimate, wonderful relationship with you? And then he goes through a list of things. He walks integrity and speaks truth in his heart. You know, doesn't take a bribe. And by verse 4, one of the evidences of a man or woman that can have intimacy with God, that can dwell in his holy tent, he swears to his own hurt and does not change. See, the fact of the matter is, there's times you make a promise based on a certain set of circumstances, and then the circumstances change, right? And you know what a man of God or woman of God does? You swear to your own hurt. I said I would do this. I said I would come. And then circumstances change, and then a man of integrity comes, or you do what you say. I got this tested just recently, and it's pretty new for me, but one of the kind of new things with walk through the Bible, you know, I'm sort of a West Coast guy for the last 12 years, and the radio ministry has been, you know, more and more moving East Coast, and it's in all the major cities now, but not at all. But when the walk through the Bible thing came, everyone thought my IQ jumped about 20 points, you know, and my spirituality must have gone up 15 points because, you know, people were asking me to speak at all these different things. And, you know, you just realize it's a stewardship and, you know, nothing changed. I didn't get any smarter and I'm certainly not any more holy, but it's just a new platform. And so they ask you to do these things. And I got a call and it was very unusual. And they were inviting, 50 or 60 people to the White House to meet with the president. And, you know, I read the news enough to know that he was going to pull together the people that were really going to pray for him. And so he asked about 50 or 60 leaders around the world here in the U.S. to come and meet. And I had committed a year before to teach at the Rural Home Mission Pastors Conference. And the Rural Home Mission Pastors Conference were guys who were pastors in very small churches in very small towns. And they came together out in Normal, Illinois. And And Dave will tell you, I mean, you don't even ask about a Starbucks or those kind of things in Normal, Illinois. In fact, we went to the post office and one of the guys said, "Hey, do you have a Starbucks?" He said, "No, but I can burn some coffee in the back and then give it to you. It tastes about the same." And, you know, there was, you know, maybe a couple hundred people. And I remember getting that invitation and having that moment of truth. And I called the guy and I said, "Boy, I got this invitation. I really need to pray about it. But I want you to know I will keep my commitment. But you pray on your end, and I want to do obviously the thing that will help the most." And so I called him, and then I actually, God blesses through Atlanta traffic. I had about 45 minutes to make my 15 or 16 minute drive home. And as I thought, I just thought to myself, you know, out of my own just personal desire and curiosity, I mean, would I like to go visit the president? Yeah. Does that sound like a lot better deal? You know, it's kind of like, would you like spinach or would you like pie a la mode? You know, which one would be really good for you, but this looks like it tastes a lot better. And, you know, it's just one of those times where by the time I got home, I knew the answer. And, you know, I made a commitment. And you just keep your commitments. You just do what you say you're going to do. And before I got home, I just called the guy and said, I prayed about it. And I said, you know what? I bet if there's 49 leaders instead of 50, probably the president will get everything that he needs. And I'm one of the younger guys, so I don't know that I bring that much to the table anyway. But, you know, it's just one of those, you know what I think God does? I think he tests us. I think God brings little tests of integrity. Are you going to keep your word? And are you going to keep your word when there's a price? And are you going to do it when it's not, you don't want to do it? We had a guy in the ministry recently, and I mean, he blew us away. John, it was last year, and we went through a big transition in the economy, really dropped, and so we had huge financial needs. And there was a fellow who had a good company out in California, actually from the same town where I was, but went to another church, and he had made a very significant, he made a $100,000 intention to give, to walk through the Bible, and his business just went south. And he just said, you know, I'm sorry, I know you all need it, and I know that all those people around the world are depending on me, but I just don't know what to do, and this is really tough. And I don't know, I can't give you the exact timing, and since I'm talking about integrity, I'll tell you, I don't remember, rather than say 2 months later. But it wasn't all that much later. We got a card from him with a check for $100,000. And he said, I got up early in the morning, and I was reading through Psalms, and I got to Psalm 15:4. And I've told God for 20-some years, this is your business. And I heard God say to me, so do you really believe that or not? If it's really my business, then why don't you keep the commitment that you weighed, swear to your own hurt, and watch me take care of you. And this summer, I got to go back, and we got to spend some time together. And I said, I just got to tell you, I mean, obviously, the finances were great for people around the world. I mean, it was awesome. Thank you. But I said, your integrity blew me away. And he said, God provided. He said, I'm not going to tell you that, you know, everything's over the top. We made it through a time I didn't know we'd make it through. The first way we take the Lord's name in vain is when we don't keep our oaths. Question. This is not an intellectual exercise. Any relationship, any commitment you've made that you have not kept your oath, that what you need to do is you need to pull out a pen and you need to make a little personal note to yourself. I need to go back and make it right with Bob or Mary. Or I need to make a phone call before I leave here. Or I need to jot a note to myself and make a commitment that when I get back, I'm going to call a breakfast meeting with so-and-so, and I'm going to own my part, and I'm going to deal with this. You know what? You're a human being. You're going to break your oaths. You're going to take the Lord's name in vain. I have. I will. But what's God want us to do? He wants us to make it right. He wants us to deal with it. And by the way, I don't know about you, but my estimation of people has often gone up when they've owned their stuff that I never dreamed they would, and when they did what was right, when it was humbling for them. And my experience too, it'll do your soul a lot of good. You know, grace flows toward humility. And I don't know anything more painful than when I've said something I shouldn't, or done something, or not followed through, and God brings it to my mind, and I've gone back to that person and said, you know something, I was at this conference up in Michigan and the weather was great and the ice cream was super and we really had a lot of fun, and a big part of me wish I would have not gone to that, you know, that Monday morning session, because it reminded me that, you know, 16 years ago I made a commitment to you and I blew it off, and I had lots of reasons and I rationalized them, but you know what? None of those reasons work. I want to be a man of integrity. I want to keep my oath. I want to be a woman of integrity. The second way that we break the third command is in our attempts to use God for personal gain. And if you write the word here, pretense. This is when we use the name of God to impress other people. I don't know if you've ever done this. Maybe you're a little tired. And have you ever been in a little small group meeting and there are people you really know? And I'm going to just admit this, so I'll get this out of the way. And, you know, you're praying and maybe you're not feeling as close to God, or you're not quite as in tune as you want to be, and your mind is kind of wandering, and there's four or five people. And I mean, it's a prayer meeting at a church and it's really important, or in a small group, and so-and-so prays and so-and-so prays and so-and-so prays. Or like Saturday morning, we were out on this piece of property praying. And as we were praying, I mean, this lady, she was so moved by God, she started to kind of weep. And you know, have you heard someone in that, you know, oh God, thank you. And down deep in your heart of hearts, you're sort of at a, oh God, I'd like to be a little more connected right now, but I'm just not quite into this at this level, but I'm going to trust by faith. But instead of praying and speaking in a tone of voice of where you're really at, you found yourself doing something like, oh God, please. Because other people in the room were praying in a way that demonstrated a level of intensity and sincerity. And what you wanted to project was you had that same level of integrity and sincerity. And the fact is, you didn't. But the way you used God's name was in a way that indicated that you were a lot closer to Him and a lot more serious about what you were praying than was really true. You ever done, has anyone other than me ever done that? Please don't raise your hands. But that's, you take the Lord's name in vain. You see, it's pretense. A second way our pretense is to exploit others for financial gain. One of the things that I go to every year now is, it's called the Christian Booksellers Association. It's this big cities, and it's the trade where all Christian books are. But they have a floor that's probably, I don't know, 6 football fields long and 3 football fields long, and they have all these vendors. You've been to these really big business conventions. And I mean, there's all the big publishers, you know, Moody and Baker and Zondervan and, you know, Tyndale, and they have their booths. And then there's about half of this thing. I mean, half of it is the stuff that they put in these Christian bookstores. I mean, Jesus vitamins. Jesus dolls, praise the Lord stickers that, I mean, anything you can imagine. I saw a new one. There was Jesus socks. I got news for you. There's going to be some people that give an account of using the name of God to sell stuff. You don't use God's name to exploit. When you hear someone in a letter or an evangelist or a Bible teacher on TV, on the radio, and say, if you don't give this money, God is going to take me home and kill me, that's called exploitation and manipulation. That's using the name of God. This ministry will not last unless you send this money. You have to do it now. God has revealed to me that you're to give it. And if you give it, I guarantee God will give it 10 times back to you. That is manipulation, that is misusing, that is lifting up or bearing or taking the name of God in vain. It's pretense, it's exploitation. Or I've actually historically seen the name of God used to justify evil and prejudice. Do you realize there were a lot of Bible-believing Christians that were saying, slavery, slavery. I mean, it's real clear. Some people are one color, other people, the Bible, you know, Cain had a mark on him. We know what the mark is. And in the name of Scripture and God, they promoted slavery, the Inquisition, the Crusades, racism. There's a lot of things been done in the name of God, the misuse of His name, that it violates the third command. Jot down, if you will, Isaiah 48:1. Hear, O Israel, house of Jacob, who swear by the name of the Lord and evoke the God of Israel, but not in truth or righteousness. Anybody here ever had someone call you from your church and you don't know them? Or get a letter from a company and you realize, how did they get my name and it sounds real personal? You know, at our church, you know, we had thousands of people involved, and so we came out with those directories, right, with the pictures. I wonder how many Christians use that directory as a mailing for their business, or for finding all the phone numbers so they can make calls to solicit business. You know what that is? That's using the name of God in vain. You know why you make a pictorial directory and put everybody's address and phone number? Is so brothers and sisters can get to know one another and love one another and support one another, not so somebody somewhere somehow can use a buck. To go to a church for business contacts, to make appearance in certain places at certain times, to be aligned with Christian things in order for financial profit, is taking the name of the Lord in vain. And God says, stop. He says, stop. Don't misuse my name. The first way is perjury. The second way is pretense. And the third is the most common in everyday irreverent conversation called profanity. This is when just words kind of casually come out of our mouth. I've divided profanity because I don't think we want to lump it in one big basket into what I call level one, level two, and level three profanity. Jesus' words make it clear that every single word that comes out of your mouth and my mouth matters to Him. Matthew 12, 36 and 37, I put it in your notes. Jesus speaking says, I say to you that every careless word that men shall speak, they shall render account for it in the day of judgment. For by your words you shall be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Well, that I don't know about you, that's a verse that I almost wish I hadn't memorized. Do you think of that? Every careless word that men shall say, you know why? It's because in Luke 6, 45, he tells us what our words really mean. That's why James in James 3 says, if you can ever get a hold of your tongue, you ever get a hold of your tongue and what comes out of your mouth, you will be able to guide your entire life. Because Jesus would teach that the good man out of the good treasure of his heart bring forth what is good, and the evil man or the evil woman brings forth what is evil. For that which fills your heart comes out of your mouth. If you ever really want to know your attitude about a person, if you ever want to know what's really going on in your heart, if you will kind of listen to your speech and your tone of voice, and whether it's negative or cynical or put down or critical, you can know exactly what's in your heart when you hear the words coming out of your mouth. And according to this, it's very clear that profanity, the casualness of our words with regard to the name of God, is serious business to Him. So level one profanity is what I called it, is casualness with God's name. Last night we sang a lot of songs and God's name came up in them. If you were thinking about God as Redeemer and Lord and what He's done for you as you sang those songs with that word, you were worshiping Him in spirit and truth. If, however, when you were singing some of those songs, your mind kind of went, and you kept saying the words, I think it's fine to stop if you need to think about something. But if you kept singing and saying the word God, but your mind was over here about a business deal when you get back, or your mind was over here, or mine was over here, in a casual way, you were saying the name Yahweh or God or Jesus, but there was no thought behind it. You weren't engaged with the author of that name, His character, His reputation, who He is and what He's done. That's casually taking the name of the Lord in vain. Or if you're like me, there's been times where in a group you couldn't think of what to say and you were just saying, Lord. Have you ever been in a prayer meeting where you wonder, people can't figure out, it's like it's a filler word. It's like a filler word. We pray to God as though evoking the name of the creator of the universe who sent His Son and died and bled and rose from the dead and will bring all of life and all the galaxies into judgment. That holy, most sacred name, we use it as a filler word. Well, I'll tell you what, that doesn't go over well in heaven. That's a casual use of His name. Or as an expression of fear. Oh, God! Or as an expression of excitement. Jesus, man alive, can that guy play? And I know what you're saying, Chip, I think you're being really picky here. You know, it just slips out. It's just a habit. I'm not really taking the Lord's name in vain. I don't mean anything by it. I really don't mean anything by it. I mean, really, I'm not taking His name in vain. I don't really mean anything by it. Listen carefully. That's the point. You don't mean anything by it. That's the point. Every time you use the name God or Lord or Jesus, and you don't mean anything by it, instead of meaning it to represent His character, His reputation, His deeds, His holiness, His love, His power, and what He means to you, it's lifting it up without purpose. It's lifting it up vainly. It's lifting it up even unintentionally with evil intent. Do you get it? Boy, you know, this is one too, I just have to confess, not growing up in the church and not studying the Ten Commandments until I was a pastor for, you know, 10, 12, 15 years. Man, I got news for you. I've violated this the greater part of my Christian life. Man, I had to start retraining my mind about what would come out of my mouth when the name Jesus or God or Lord. The second level of profanity is contempt for God's name. This is calculated malice toward God. This is a line I saw in a little Bart Simpson cartoon where Bart bows his head and says, "We made all this stuff, so thanks God for nothing." It's just contempt. This is the Da Vinci Code. This is when someone who says this is all based on historical fact and they make Jesus out to be having an affair with Mary Magdalene and all this gross kind of stuff, or the last temptation of Christ where Jesus is a homosexual, that's contempt for God's name. The third way, third level of profanity, is cursing God's name. Literally, when someone says, take this in the right spirit since we're teaching, God damn something, they're uttering a prayer. God damn, they're asking that the one who has the power to separate someone from him all eternally and place them apart from Christ and his love forever and ever, they're uttering a prayer, God, I want you to damnate this person and their soul forever and ever. That's what people are saying when they use the name of the Lord in vain. And notice Exodus 27 says, I, the Lord, will punish anyone who misuses my name. And jot down under that, just before you turn the page, Leviticus 24. If by chance you're thinking, you know what, the first two commands, I was with you, I think you just went a little bit over the top. You know, I think you're being a little bit too nitpicky. Leviticus 24 is the first violation of the third command I can find in Scripture. Can anyone tell me, two men are fighting, and in their fighting, one of them takes the name of the Lord in vain. You know, I can only guess, you know, he caught a right uppercut, and, you know, then he got hit in the stomach, and then he got really upset, and then he blurted out the name of the Lord in vain. Can anyone tell me that was the offense? What was the punishment? It was capital punishment. They were to stone him to death. See, here's what I want you to know. God's name isn't something to be carelessly thrown about. God's name is holy. God's name is reputation. God's name is who he is. God's name is what he's done. When it comes to our lips, our hearts and our minds need to be filled with who the God of the universe is, what he's like, what he's done, and what he means to us. And you know, here's the deal. If you, over time, can discipline and practice and ask the grace of God to help you do that, if you never take the name of the Lord in vain, you'll never violate commands number 1 and 2. Because there'll be no other gods before you, because you'll be thinking about them in a way like never before. And I'll tell you what, your means of worship, it will be holy. It'll be the right way. There won't be any idols, because his name and who he is and what he's done will come out of your mouth in such a way that some major transformation will have occurred in your heart. Well, let me apply this as we wrap it up, because here is, I think, a pretty important question, is why is it then that otherwise intelligent people profane God's name? I mean, I'm just going to guess, in a group this size, there's got to be a handful of people at least who basically came into this morning, had a nice breakfast, thought it was going to be a real nice sunny day, a little bit cooler than you thought, but it was going to be a great time around God's Word, and you're now sitting here in your most honest moments thinking, I take the name of the Lord in vain on a regular basis, and whoa. So how could a person who loves God like you, who's an intelligent person, find themselves sitting in a room where you came to learn about the Bible and possibly be someone who takes his name in vain on a regular basis? How could that happen? I've got three explanations. One, the spiritually uninformed. You just simply don't know better. You know? It was like, you know what? I heard don't take the name of the vain in Lord, I can say this. Don't take, help me, the name of the Lord in vain. And I thought that was not cussing. And I do pretty good. I mean, now and then with a hammer on my thumb, it sort of pops out, but I'm, you know, I don't cuss. I don't take the name of the Lord in vain. You were spiritually ignorant, okay, until this morning. Consider yourself now informed. Okay? Consider yourself now culpable before the God of the universe to take his name with a new level of seriousness like never before. And you know what? It will do something marvelous for your spiritual life. It really will. Because see what we have? What we have going is, here's the view that we have of God. God is small. God is trite. God isn't holy. You know what? He's become everybody's good buddy. He's been everybody's self-help genie. I want you to know that the God of the Bible is to be feared with reverential awe. He's a consuming fire. We need to get this balance of his great compassion, and we need to get this sense of his otherness and his holiness and his creatorship. We need to get a high view of God. It is only when you have a high view of God that out of reverential fear, you obey him. The beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. And it is almost absent in the church today. Everyone's stooping so much, we got to connect with the culture. I got news with you. I think we can connect with the culture, but I think we've fallen into the culture. I see more of the culture in the church than I see the church transforming the culture. And it starts with me. Starts with you. This, you know, let's quit blaming Hollywood and the culture and the newspapers and the magazines and all this junk and what's on TV. They only put on movies and on TV what people buy. And we claim to be 40 plus million of Americans. If every Christian had a high view of God, Hollywood would go broke. No, they wouldn't. You know what they do? They're smart. They're not trying to pollute the world. They're trying to make money. It's just easy to make pollution type films because people will pay to see them. If the standard was, this is what we accept, and they made the highest margins on this kind of money, I'll tell you what, movies would change. So let's not throw stones at what ought to happen out there. Let's ask God for us, beginning with us individually, that we repent and we get a high view of God and we live differently and we speak differently and we have this standard. And when all of our Christian friends say, oh, that movie was good except for this, 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 and that, and you say, you know what? It's this, this, and that makes it unacceptable to me. God bless you. You have your convictions, I have mine. I'm not going to support that kind of garbage. And you say it lovingly, nicely, winsomely, without a self-righteous, judgmental type attitude that I sort of just threw in there, so you can do better than me. Second is not only the spiritually uninformed, but the spiritually undisciplined. You know, you're a believer, you're trying, it just slips out. Casual profanity. And what I would suggest is, if it slips out, whether it's casual profanity with God's name or whether it's cursing, I would suggest that rather than get all down on yourself, what I would say is there's probably something that God wants to do in your heart. In other words, if God's name is casual, there's something that's disconnected between your heart and His. If you still find yourself swearing, you know, different people struggle with different stuff, but in the first few months, actually, I swore like a sailor all my years growing up. But as I got into the Bible, and no one told me I had to, but I went to a camp and I started reading morning and night, morning and night, morning and night. As my mind got renewed, I can't tell you the day, I can't remember when I quit cussing. But all I can tell you was, if you are in the Bible on a regular basis and digesting it, God will clean up your tongue, because your tongue is just a mirror of what's going on down here. If you got a real problem with profanity and you're a believer and boy, you know, you say, boy, damn, wish I could quit. And oh gosh, that's not right. You know, I'm just saying, I got friends, you know, I'm glad they're honest, but you know what it usually tells me? It usually tells me there's a deficiency of what's going in their mind and their heart. And God wants to deal with something down in here. And then third is what I call the spiritually dead. I want to guard God's name, but you know, people that don't know God, it doesn't bother them when they take His name in vain. They don't even hear themselves. And I have not taken it upon myself to be the Holy Spirit police for unbelievers. When people don't know God, they're going to take His name in vain. And I think there's some creative ways when people are cussing like that. And as I read recently, one guy said, boy, you do a lot of your praying in public, don't you? And the guy said, well, man, what are you talking about? And he was GD this and GD that. He said, well, you understand that you're uttering a prayer. And you know, I don't expect, what it tells me is when people have very, very foul mouths and use God's name in vain, it tells me they're not connected with Him and they don't know Him and they have great spiritual need. And what I need to do is have compassion. I need to pray. I need to move into their life. And my goal is not to figure out how I can clear up their tongue. That you know what? That's just the evidence. My goal is to figure out how can God use me to reach their heart. And by the way, if you happen to, you know, and someone invited you to the camp, and I kind of don't know who comes to these camps, but if you just cuss and swear on a regular basis, and everything I said is like, this doesn't bother me at all, then I would say, examine yourself. Because if the Spirit of God lives in you, then His name will matter to you, because His character and His reputation is important to you, and what He did on the cross is paramount to your life. And therefore, there will be a sensitivity to the name of Jesus. There will be a sensitivity to the name of God and Lord. And so I would encourage you just together to do a little analysis and say, Lord, could I unconsciously or consciously be a part of breaking oaths, perjury, and taking Your name in vain? Could I unconsciously or consciously have a level of pretense in my life where I actually use Your name as sort of a door opener in relationships or even financial exploitation? And then, Lord, is there profanity? I mean, is it casual level one unthinking and I just need to, you know, jolt and get really clear on this? Or You know, is it level 2 or level 3? And when you take the name of God seriously, you will find your view of God will get large and big and holy. And you will find a lot of other, like dominoes, things will get solved in your heart and your life.
As we wrap up this message, there may be some next steps you need to take, and we'd like to help you on that journey. If today's topic raised some additional questions or issues that you'd like to explore more in depth, take a look at Chip's series, God as He Longs for You to See Him. In addition, be sure to take some time to visit our website, where you'll find a number of free resources, information on all our audio and video series, as well as timely updates and information from Chip. The web address is simply livingontheedge.org. That's livingontheedge.org.